How's your, how are the web?
I still use my tablet, which is so frail.
Oh, well, keep exercising it though, if I can.
Do you have to declare a winner?
And I will email you directions to cancel.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's the same place.
I was thinking about applying, but I thought I might be surprised. Because I'm so invested in the topic.
We're gonna have to have a couple of hours, so.
Here you go. I can give it a shot.
Hey, Mike.
Hey.
Well, it's flexible.
These chairs are gonna be moved by then because they're going to be arranged. We'll have a panel discussion of these chairs. By then, I kind of want to see. Yeah, exactly, by then.
I gotta finish this.
Oh, good, yes. Do you know Michael?
That's an interesting one to pick, but thanks for coming. That's good. Okay. Oh, right, you also, did she came to visit you? Joy? Did she came to visit you?
Yes.
BFFs. No, B, it is best friends forever. So there's a chair, there, still. But this is one for you.
But this is a.
No, this is a good one here. Sit here. No, I'm serious. This is good. Come here.
I'll fall asleep in there.
No, you won't. This is good modern Bauhaus design. It's not too comfortable.
Dan Gerald was a big fan of God. Actually, the book is, I was asked, Peggy Taylor asked me to write a review letter for promotion of this Yugoslavian critic who teaches us that. Yes, right.
He's a very.
He's very good. They sent me, have you read his book on the Balkan Wars that just came out?
I haven't, no, but I've read. Some form or another, I've seen.
So I thought maybe I'll do this.
I know, we were on the surfer, yes.
Oh, I didn't know that, no. The book here is just wonderful. And it's kind of the kind of thing that John McKenzie would dream of doing. That is to say, really taking performativity, connecting performance art with social, economic, cultural developments in the world. Well, he's just very smart. I was really impressed. I passed the book on to Corey. I said, this is a book you must know.
He's a chair of the
Well, apparently he's up now for promotion. I wrote a very enthusiastic letter. But anyway, that's his book.
Yeah, I saw that. No, let's have a look at it.
He's a very wonderful, very traditional. I go out there. People do that fairly often.
He's had a bit of a revival. Several hours of work on the next day.
Oh, really?
Chris is.
So,
but we already did the Chris a few years ago.
Oh, I know that, yeah.
And help with somebody else.
There was some experimental company about 10 years ago.
it's academic and it's theater, the place where they both meet.
We have the audience and participant for each other.
Intellectual practices, historical practices, cultural practices.
Examples of women.
It's the projector. I don't know what
you do, sharing how you do that.
There's no way you can ignore Latinos anymore.
Work from all around the world, you can come and see and talk about.
Education changes people. Education changes communities. Education is the key for any society to prosper.
Just the mention of Darwin was considered at that time something unacceptable to the faith, a great scandal.
UB was the first university in the region to accept women students. It was a very daring decision for the leaders of the university to take.
60 countries, every religious faith and sect you could think of.
Violence in Beirut, killings, they were shelling.
He opened a briefcase and there was a gun there.
You just didn't know what was going to happen from week to week.
Two has been arrested on the road, some killed, some kidnapped. It was like a survival group.
It's not about that one chapter in the book. They teach you who you should be and how you can reach places.
The history of this region is complementary, and this opens the mind.
Welcome everybody to the Martin E. Siegel Theater Center here at the Graduate Center CUNY, and welcome in the green room of the PhD program in theater. My name is Frank Henschke, and I'm the director of the Siegel Center, and it's our great pleasure tonight to welcome you all here, but especially to celebrate this truly significant evening tonight, an opening of a relation with the American University in Beirut. The projector seems to have different format than our Siegel Center projector downstairs, but I think you did get, you know, the story of what those films are trying to tell. So I have with me Peter Eckersall, Professor Peter Eckersall, who's the executive officer of the program and also, of course, a professor here at the PhD program in theater. And next is Sahar, who traveled all the way from the American University in Beirut, and where she leads the theater initiative, and she will also tell us more about the work. If you have a cell phone, please do take it out for the moment and see if it's off. And we also, of course, would like to welcome Professor Marvin Carlson, who is here, the professor of theater and the expert of Arab theater in the Americas, and Catania from the Health Center, who came to join us. Joe Cicero, thank you, a board member who came and out of interest also for this program. And the provost and the president of the Graduate Center CUNY were not able to join us tonight. They had a long-standing appointment at the French embassy tonight, and we got this evening and this program, this exchange on a very, very short notice. This was the evening we had. Peter is leaving tomorrow for Paris and then Canada and then also to Shanghai, where we will also open on November 1st the Marvin Carlson Theater Center in Shanghai, which will also be a new collaboration also with the Siegelson and the Graduate Center. So we are really exploring our networks and our longstanding connections to scholars and visiting scholars from all around the world. Again, thank you for coming. It shouldn't be longer than an hour 15 minutes. Here in the very same room will be a reception. This is under the white, because they have some wonderful Lebanese food also. Again, thank you all for coming, Peter.
Thank you. Yeah, we have beautiful wafting smells of the food, so I hope you can stay around for some food afterwards. So, as Frank said, my name's Peter Eckersall, and I'm the Executive Officer of the PhD Program in Theatre here at the Graduate Centre, and a rare Siegel event that we're actually in the green room of the theatre program. And so we do a lot of work together with the Siegel Centre. A lot of our practice-based research is kind of work that we do in partnership with the Siegel Centre. And this particular project, I think, is an example of the really productive relations that we can forge, not only between the teaching program at the Graduate Centre in Theatre and the Siegel Centre, but also with American University of Beirut. So I'm just going to say very briefly how very pleased we are to be working on this very new exchange project. So this is the first of a series of events that will be taking place initially as a pilot program over the next year, and then fully expect that this will continue to be a very productive program of exchange for both faculty and students between our program in theatre and the theatre initiative at the American University of Beirut. So tonight we have Sahar, in a sense, doing an inaugural presentation of this exchange. So she's here as our guest, and tomorrow we'll be having a series of meetings, not only among our faculty, but also with some of our provost to discuss building the relationship into the future, because this is a new exchange that we're launching. Just to briefly mention some of the activities that we've got planned for the exchange already, and just keeping in mind that this is something that we're still developing, so we will be thinking about other activities that we might add in the future. But first of all, there will be at some stage a visit by myself and Frank, and even last night I was talking to our provost Joy Connolly, and she was saying, "Oh, I'd like to come along." So I've also had discussions with Catherine Cole, who runs the James Gallery downstairs on the ground level. She's also very interested, and so there might be a I will go and talk to the theatre program and maybe do some of my work on dramaturgy with the students there. But we're looking at the possibility of having a visit by some of the, I guess, the people who are doing the kind of cultural work in the program, in the Graduate Centre. Next year, our colleague Professor Robert Myers, who's a very close colleague of Marvin's, who's a translator of Arabic plays, will be running a conference at the American University of Beirut, and it's planned that our colleague Professor Jean Graham-Jones, who's an expert in theories of translation, will attend that conference, along with, we hope, two students from our program, who will go there and present work from their dissertations, work in progress. So they'll be essentially participating in the academic conference down there. Meanwhile, one of the things we're going to talk about tomorrow is the plans for a conference back here next year, which will be in partnership with the Siegel Centre on the theme broadly of Asian dramaturgy. I'm an Asianist, so I just always default to Asia. Arabic dramaturgies, the concept of dramaturgy and how it relates to theatre and performance in the Mideast, and perhaps specifically to some of the examples of really exciting cultural production that's happening in Lebanon. And it's proposed that faculty and students will come from AUB to that program. And then the other thing that we have planned for at the moment is a series of perhaps documentations and publications. But as I said, this is a work in progress. It's something that we're developing. We already have, I think, three or four events that are in planning, but we're looking forward to developing more. So very much welcome you to New York and to the Graduate Center. And it's a great pleasure to have your presentation
today.
Thank you.
Tonight,
so
thank you. All right. Thank you. I'm tonight and to speak to you on behalf of the Theatre Initiative at the American University of Beirut. I would like to thank a few people who were instrumental in bringing this partnership into being between CUNY's PhD program in theatre and performance, the Siegel Center, and the Theatre Initiative at EUP. Thank you, President Chase Robinson and President Faldokhouri, who initiated this project. Thank you, Provost Joy Connolly of CUNY and Dean of Arts and Sciences at AUB, Nadia Sheikh. Thank you, Marvin Carlson, Frank Henschker, and Peter Eckersall, and Jean Graham Jones, and our very own Robert Myers, who made this collaboration happen within months after visits by our two presidents and the initial talks. In the last 10 years, in spite of the precarious political and security situation of the country and the region, Lebanon and Beirut, in particular, witnessed an upsurge in theatrical activity. New companies emerged. Pioneers of the pre-Civil War era are presenting new work. The post-Civil War generation of artists continue to present their work. Artists who left the country during the Civil War to live and study and train in the US and Europe have come back to contribute to the theatrical scene, which is very diverse. Practitioners have contradictory aesthetics, but they share intuition and passion and a real sense of political and social commitment and a common objective, that is to resist the status quo by maintaining a vibrant theatrical scene. A broad look at the contemporary Lebanese theater reflects how it's developing really under the influence of its historical and socio-political conditions, as well as in relation to the influence of Western theater. For some practitioners, theater is a political instrument to raise awareness, expose social and political ills, and incite change and self-examination. In their mission statement, for instance, the award-winning ensemble Zuqaq, founded just after the 2006 war, expressed their dedication to theater practice, and I quote, as social and political involvement with a belief in theater as a space for common reflection and in collectivity as a position against marginalizing systems, end quote. Their repertoire of more than 15 productions tackle various themes such as the structures of power, gender and sexuality, and death and immortality. Yeah, no problem. We have some nice pictures there. Okay, this is Zuqaq. Collective Kahraba, founded in 2007 by artists and technicians from different fields, is another example of theater makers working collectively on the premise that art is a pathway for dialogue and openness. Perhaps the company's most impressive achievement is the free multidisciplinary festival, Us, the Moon, and the Neighbors, which they started in 2011 in the popular neighborhood of Marm Khayel in Beirut. The festival expanded this year to Hammana Village in Mount Lebanon and took place at Hammana Artist House, a recently opened residency house under the artistic direction of Collective Kahraba. Like Zuqaq and Collective Kahraba, emerging company Minwal, founded in 2014, aspires to decentralize theater by providing theater workshops for youth in various marginalized areas in the country. The company is interested in, and I quote, researching, developing frameworks for theater productions and activities that assess the realities of humankind in relation to the various crises it faces, end quote. To devise their work, they built on Arabic literature and contemporary international philosophy and also on multimedia. Many other artists also use theater as a social tool and write and revise their plays through the process of rehearsal, thus utilizing the formula of collective creation, although not necessarily in the framework of a company or an ensemble. Women directors are especially active in Lebanon. To name a few, Lina Abyad is one of the most prominent and prosperous directors. In the last couple of years, she devised documentary pieces on a range of issues such as domestic violence and the Syrian refugee crisis. Ali Al-Khalidi, another example, recently conceived and directed a biographical performance based on her grandmother, Ambara Salam, who was an early Arab feminist, often credited with being the first Muslim woman to remove her veil in public in the near Middle East in 1927. Hanan Haj Ali, another example, recently wrote and directed and acted in her performance Jogging, a one-woman show that revisits the actress's dreams, aspires, hopes, and disillusions. Of the younger generation, I have the example of Yara Bounassar, who's an emerging director who uses documentary material in her work to expose and deconstruct social stereotypes. Contemporary theater in Lebanon is also influenced by Western theater traditions, especially with regard to dramaturgy. The figure that remains, relatively speaking, absent from the Lebanese theatrical scene is that of the playwright. Theater makers compensate for the absence of the playwriting tradition by translating and adapting Western texts. Examples here are plenty. To name a few from recent history, Lebanese actor and director Jacques Maroun commissioned a translation of and directed David Ives' Venus and Fair and Neil LaBute's Reasons to be Pretty. Actor, filmmaker, and stage director Carlos Shaheen, who recently moved back to Lebanon from Paris, translated and directed Yasmina Reza's God of Carnage and Donald Margulies' Dinner with Friends. With Tahwil Ensemble Theater, I recently co-translated and co-directed Tracy Lett's August Osage County. Lina Khoury translated and adapted Eve Ensler's Vagina Monologues and Paula Vogel's How I Learned to Drive. Perhaps these productions have no direct political implications, but their value lies not only in introducing Lebanese theater goers to modern and contemporary international theater, but also in bringing new audiences to the Beiruti theaters. By presenting accessible text-based theater that follows a clear storyline, they're making theater available to a larger segment of the society. Contemporary Lebanese theater is developing rapidly thanks to the companies and theater makers who persist despite the various problems and obstacles they face. From the lack of governmental support to financial problems to an unstable security situation to problems regarding the relationship with audiences to lack of proper theater infrastructures as well as the censorship that still operates in Lebanon to this day and is responsible for banning several theater makers from presenting their work. The examples I mentioned are by no means comprehensive of practitioners and genres. Improvisational theater, for example, most prominently Sundayers, puppet theater such as Khayal Ensemble, drama therapy, especially by Catharsis and Zaina Dakash, playback theater, Leban Company, and other forms constitute a significant part of the contemporary Lebanese theater landscape. Driven by a strong passion for theater and a sturdy conviction concerning its role in helping us understand our humanity, the theater initiative at AUB had made a special place for itself in this vibrant theater landscape within a couple of years of its having been established. Before I speak about our work at the theater initiative, allow me to briefly contextualize it within the history of theater at AUB. Theatrical activity has been present at AUB since the 1920s. However, because it was never institutionalized, such activities were always sporadic, as they were always linked to personal initiatives, a passionate student or a passionate teacher. So it would prosper at points and then fade away when these students graduated or teachers left. Christopher Scaff was one of the teachers who made an impact. When he moved to Beirut after graduating from Oxford University to work at AUB, he founded the English Drama Players. The plays that the troupe presented were always in English and from the English repertoire. However, English Drama Players had two spin-offs, the New Theatre Group and the Phoenix Players, both founded by students who worked with Scaff. Beirut's Theater Ensemble was another important group established at AUB pre-Civil War era. It was founded by David Kourani and Peter Shbeya, both still teach at AUB, upon their return from Lebanon after finishing their studies at the Old Vic. The company was active from 1968 to 1972 and presented works by Sophocles, Shakespeare, Goldoni, Brecht, Chekhov, Shaw, Pinter, Ibsen, and others. The company also presented work in Arabic, such as The Fate of a Cockroach by the Egyptian Tawfiq al-Hakim. The three men would swap roles, acting, directing, and producing. Despite the fact that these initiatives were very important, they faced a common challenge, which is succinctly stated by Lebanese historian Khalida Saeed in her prominent book on the theater movement in Lebanon from 1965 to 1975. As Saeed said, Lebanese theater makers would rarely attend the shows presented by AUB troops, except perhaps for the shows that were presented off campus at Beirut Theater or Baalbek Theater. Both don't exist anymore. When renowned writer Mary Hani attended Brecht's Mother Courage by Berita's Theater Ensemble, she wrote a review of the play for Al-Nahar newspaper, and she closed her review with her bafflement that the Arabic and French theater makers in the country did not attend these plays. As Saeed stated, these activities established a huge legacy at the university for its students and also for the Arab students who went back home and contributed to the theater making in the respective countries. Their lasting effect on the Lebanese theatrical scene, however, is less tangible. This, perhaps, is what distinguishes today the theater initiative. The kind of work that the theater initiative at AUB has been engaged in serves many purposes. It satisfies its role as university theater by exposing students to and engaging them in the educational and cultural aspects of theater study and practice. The model that Robert Myers and I created allows the students to work side by side with professional actors and designers and to participate in the creation of a theater production from A to Z while engaging in extensive historical and cultural research around the place. At the same time, the theater initiative engages with the Lebanese theater goer by presenting work that responds to and comments on issues of concern to the public, and work that complements the Lebanese theater scene and fills in its gaps. A renowned critic in Al Akhbar newspaper referred to our 2006 production of Shakespeare's King Lear as a gift to the Lebanese theater. The production was part of the worldwide celebrations of the 400th anniversary of Shakespeare's death and the 105th anniversary of AUB, and for the first time it presented Shakespeare to the Lebanese theater goers in colloquial Arabic. The theater initiative was officially established in 2015, but Robert Myers has been laying its foundation since his arrival at AUB in 2004. Before he came to Beirut, his plays were produced off-Broadway in New York, in Chicago, Washington, Atlanta, Los Angeles, and elsewhere. And he worked as a playwright at Dartmouth and Wesleyan, and in Rio de Janeiro, Amman, and Damascus. His work is focused on charged social, political, and historical subjects, and he has continued his engaged project while at AUB. Writing Unmanned about drone pilots, Twilight Country about racism in the US South in the 1940s, and Mesopotamia about Gertrude Bell and the British occupation of Iraq, as well as translating contemporary political plays from the Arab world with Nada Saab. In 2013, Robert and I collaborated on staging Rituals of Science and Transformations by Sa'dallah Wanous, which was translated into English by Myers and Nada Saab. Since then, we have presented a range of activities. We produced more than six plays, some text-based, such as The Dictator, written in 1969 by Lebanese playwright and poet Issam Mahfouz, and tells the story of a tyrant, a mentally disturbed individual, under the illusion that he is humanity's long-awaited savior, and his comic and unpredictable assistant, Sa'doun. Another example of a text-based is The Rape, written by Syrian playwright Sa'dallah Wanous in 1989, and dramatizes the use of rape as a technique of interrogation by the Israeli Shin Bet in the West Bank during the First Intifada. We also presented devised original work, such as Watch Your Step, a site-specific promenade performance produced in Arabic and English in the Khanta al-Ghamid neighborhood of Beirut about Lebanon's civil war. The work took the form of a faux architectural tour in a war-torn area in which the audience was led by tour guides who were actors. In the course of the tour, audience members encountered real-life scenes alongside stage scenes based on events that took place during the Lebanese Civil War. Most recently, we created No Demand, No Supply, a documentary performance lecture on the sex trafficking case that was uncovered in Lebanon in 2016, and which we will be reading parts of tonight. We presented our work off Broadway as part of the Between the Seas Festival at the Siegel Center, McGill University, Silk Road Rising in Chicago, Antonin Louis Theatre in Belgium, and most recently at the Between the Seas Festival in Athens, Greece. We have produced translations and scholarly work for Yale University Press, CUNY Siegel Center, Gale Publishing, Page, and others. In the past 3 years, we have co-sponsored academic conferences such as an international conference on Darwin, AUB, and the Arab world. We have presented several staged readings, organized workshops, hosted master classes, and theater talks. Our latest guest was Donald Margulies, whose talk was in conjunction with the presentation of his play, Dinner with Friends, in Arabic at Mono Theater. We also hosted the acclaimed Lebanese stage director and actor, Roger Assaf, in a series of master classes that will culminate at the end of this month in a devised piece based on Aeschylus, Agamemnon, and Euripides, Trojan Women at Sunflower Theater in Beirut. Our upcoming works include publications with Brill Leiden on modern and contemporary Levantine political theater by Robert Myers and Nada Saab, and on Wannous, edited by Myers and Sonia Mesher Atassi, which has been submitted to the Cambridge University Press. We're also preparing for a production of Garcia Lorca's Blood Wedding in Arabic, which will be presented in conjunction with an international conference organized by Robert on Latin America, Al-Andalus, and the Arab world. Among the participants will be Marvin Carlson and Jean Graham Jones of CUNY and some students, hopefully. We're also in conversations with Anne Cattaneo at Lincoln Center to establish Director's Lab Mediterranean to be held annually at AUB. Once more, on behalf of the Theater Initiative, thank you Marvin, Frank, and Peter for helping to bring this partnership into being between our institutions. This partnership will most certainly enable us to continue to produce work of international quality and to meet our goal of institutionalizing theater at AUB. Thank you.
That's a wonderful introduction, and I think not only a very impressive introduction to a part of the world that the theater community is not really terribly aware of, but also a suggestion of what a rich and active producing and publishing and writing world it is. So. We're very excited to be developing a connection with it that I know will be enormously helpful and productive for both programs. We're going now, I think one thing that we should try to do is get everybody in seats. There are a few chairs back here. There's a spare chair over here. Let's get as many people seated as we can.
Okay.
For the next part of the program, and this will be a sampling of the rich dramatic literature that has already been mentioned. So, how is this going to be done? Are we going to have a set of chairs here, or what's the?
Yeah, maybe you tell us a little bit about the play and give an introduction.
We do the reading.
We do the reading now.
Yes, we're going to go to the reading now. Yeah. You lead us in there. You mentioned the play, but
I'll just give a brief introduction so that it's really put in context, so that you will, enjoy, and it's going to be hard to enjoy, but let me just read this introduction. So on the 27th of March, 2016, the Inquisitorial Commission in Mount Lebanon raided silver and Chez Maurice brothels in Junye area, east of Beirut, and saved 75 Syrian refugee women from what became known later as the largest sex trafficking network in the history of Lebanon. The story gained huge media attention as the women told horrifying stories about the torture and abuse they suffered at the hands of one of the lead figures of the network, which was making more than $1 million a month, according to the police reports. Few weeks after the uncovering of the story, the mainstream media lost interest in it, and slowly it started fading into oblivion. A year later, and as part of the Center of Arts and Humanities Conference at the American University of Beirut on post-war reconstruction in Syria, Iraq, Yemen, and Palestine, I presented the premiere of No Demand, No Supply in the form of a documentary performance lecture using Eliki Blight's recorded delivery technique, which requires actors on stage to listen to live audio recordings through earphones and repeat exactly what they hear. The performance was my attempt to giving voice to the stories of the rescued women, while I tried to comprehend how such a trafficking network could sustain itself for 10 years in a country as small as Lebanon. I could not forget the story when it was dropped from the mainstream media, and I really didn't want to forget it. I felt responsible towards the women survivors. Tonight, reading will give you just a gist of the performance with a focus on the women's testimonies. Jenny Youssef will be the narrator. Lynn Hudaib will repeat the testimony of Ruba, a pseudonym, and I will repeat the testimony of Noor, also a pseudonym.
On Friday, the 25th of March, 2016, four Syrian women ran away from Shemoris, the nightclub where they were imprisoned and forced into prostitution. They got into a van and asked the driver to take them to the Hadath area in the southern suburb of Beirut. The driver, who turned out to be an informant to the Mount Lebanon District Investigative Police, called the colonel and told him that he had four women riding with him, claiming that they were forced into prostitution. When the colonel sent the patrol, the officer told him, "Sir, these women are whores. Let us hand them over to the Bureau of Morals so we don't have to withstand their smell," literally. The colonel asked, "Are they beaten up?" The informant said, "Yes, but perhaps because they are wild." On Friday, the four girls arrived at the office of the investigative police and told their story. They were kept at the precinct until the colonel fact-checked the story. 2 days later, the colonel sent out 12 patrol cars, six to Shemoris and six to Silver. The women got a hold of the officer and said, "We beg you, take us with you." After the raid, and before the girls were referred to various NGOs, Sandy Aissa, the investigative reporter from At-Tahrir, interviewed them at length.
جيت عن طريق سيد أحمد شاهين اللي شغل بمطعم وأخي غياس تفضع هونيك بيستلم وفي شغل هونيك بالمطعم ما بتكوني إلا رضيان. اجيت على لبنان وجابني وصلني على شيموريس. شافني قال لي شغل هيك هيك. قلت له أنا ما بدي أشتغل. قلت له بدي أرجع لعند أهلي ولعند أمي. قال لي لا أنت ما في رجع هلأ. صرتي عندي هون. ما بترجع. ضربني يوم كف. جيت تحت الطاولة. تاني كف جيت بالحمام. لأنه الكف اللي عنده زلمي ما بيتحمل. قال لي بتضلي عندي شهرين. وقلت له لغياس المصاري انت بدك تسدي لي اياهم وبعدين بتفلي. ضليت شهر بالشيموريس وبعدين انتقلت على السيلفر.
The working hours at Shemoris were from 9 a.m. till 6 a.m. Imad al-Rihawi, the trafficker, had them working two shifts, torturing them in between.
كان الشغل عم يرتب الأغراض تبعولنا على الدرج من فوق. تخبيت أنا جوا عم شوفه إذا بده ينزل ولا لا. يعني أنا ما عم بتطلع عليه لهذا الشخير. عم بتطلع على الدرج من تحت. فزت علي رفيقتي إسمالينا. قال هيدي عم تطلع على الشخير. بس قولي ما حكت شي. تركت ليجي السيد عماد. بس اجى عماد قالت له لينا هاي البنت كانت عم تطلع على الشغيل بدها تحكي معه. بس اجى حطني على الطاولة واحدة من الطاولات عنا خربانة خشبتها. شال الخشبة وقعت الخشبة كنت وقعت. شال الخشبة حطها على جنب، ربط لي إجري صلبني، ربط لي إجري صلبني مثل الصليب. 30 كرباجة كانت، 30 مبريش.
Some women were sold by their families and friends to Ahmed Bihawi, such as Lana, who came to Shemadis at the age of 17. She was sold by the same friend who saved her from her husband, who was prostituting her. Ahmed told her that she had to work for 2 months to repay the money that he had paid her friend. The 2 months meant a life sentence. She had been locked up for 2 years when the raid happened. Noor had been there for 9 days. She came to Shemadis with three of her friends from Syria. They were promised jobs at a restaurant. When they arrived, they discovered that Ahmed had paid $6,000 to the person who brought them. He then forced them to stay and repay him the money by beating and torturing them.
الوحشية اللي أنا شفتها خلال هالتسعة أيام ما شفتها بحياتي. كون أيام بغرفتي بتذكر أشياء كتير طبعاً، شيء ما بينتسى. إني كنت عم تغتصبي كل نهار، مو مرة عم تغتصبي. اللي بتنام أكتر، اللي بتطلع أكتر مع الزباين فوق العشر مرات، هاي بتكون طاب. بتكون 10 مرات، 15 مرة، ويا ما في بنات طالعة 20 مرة على الدرج ونازلة مع الزباين.
The sex buyer is the missing link in this story. The women at Shemoris would see 10 to 15 clients per day, 7 days a week, no days off. They worked even when they were sick or menstruating.
كنت ساخنة. قلت لهم أنا ما حقدر أشتغل. بدي أسبوع لحتى أقدر أشتغل إذا بدكم أشتغل. قال لي، قلت لهم أنا ساخنة. قال بدنا نشوف. قلت له شو بدك تشوفي؟ قال بدي أشوف إنك ساخنة. قلت له لا أكيد ما حتشوفي يعني. تخيلي حدا حاطط كف بإيدوه بده يشوف إذا ساخنة ولا لا. قلت له لا ما حتشوفي. قال إيه المسا بس يجي معلميك هو بيشوف. إجا المسا بتخليها بشوف، لا ما بخليها تشوف. ضليت آكل قتل 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 لحتى آخر شي تأكدت إنه أنا ساخنة. تأكدت، فوتوني لجوا على الغرفة ومسكوني وعرفوا إنه أنا ساخنة. قال إيه البنت ساخنة. قال إيه بدك تشتغلي. قلت لهم كيف بدي أشتغل وأنا ساخنة؟ قال بتفوتي هلا على الحمام، صبايا بعلموك كيف تحطي قطني. فتت علموني كيف حط قطني، صرت حط قطني واشتغل، حط قطني واشتغل.
Some of the women survivors who escaped said that they were forced to have sex with 20 customers per day. 75 girls times 20 times 7 days a week. Is that a lot? Let's assume then that each girl was seeing one buyer a day, 1 times 75 times 7. 525 buyers a week, which means 2,100 a month, which makes 25,200 a year. If we assume that each girl was seeing one buyer a day, and the buyer was paying only 50,000 Lebanese pounds, $33, excluding tips, so 2,100 buyers times $33 would make $70,000 a month. That is, if we assume that each girl was seeing one customer a day. The buyers were the link that no one mentioned when the story was uncovered. The mainstream media denounced the abortion doctor who confessed that he did 200 operations and got paid for each one, and the security authorities who were facilitating and protecting the trafficker's job. But no one talked about the buyers. Thousands of men who were intentionally or ignorantly participating in the crime of Shemoris evaporated as if they had never existed. From an economic point of view, the equation is simple. No demand, no supply. Why is it important to understand the demand? Because it is the essence of the matter. It is clear that the demand at Shemoris was very high. 10 years, 75 girls, 7 working days a week, 2 shifts, 2,100 clients at least per week. 100% of the clients were men. The number of clients arrested during the raid was 3, even though according to the colonel, the place was packed. The number of clients who noticed that the girls were beaten up and tortured is undefined. The number of clients who tried to report the matter to the police is zero.
بيمسكها هيك بإيدها بدورها بعليلها فستانها سوري بيضربها أيام على طيزة إذا قالت الآي بصوت كتير مغري بياخدها وإذا نترت بوجهه طبعا هاي بنحط الأكس يعني حتساوي كل اللي بده إياه بيقلها مثلا سوري أنا بدي بحب إني أنا معك من ورا ما بحقلها تقول لا ما بحقلها تقول لا أبدا ويا ما في بنات ما كانوا انه هني سوري مفتوحين من ورا يا ما عماد قعدن على القنيني قعدن على القنيني
سبون شو بيفكر انه كل البنات اللي فاتوا على المكان تبع الشيموريز بيفكر انه البنت جاي بخاطره بيفكر انه البنت عارفانه انه هي جاي كل البنات او 90% من البنات او بدي اقول لك 100% من البنات كل البنات اجوا بخدعة هاي الا شغل بالسوبر ماركت هاي الا شغل بالصيدلية هاي الا شغل بمطعم هاي الا شغل بديسكو هاي الا شغل بنادي هاي الا هيك كل البنات اللي اجوا اللي اجوا واللي انا حكيت معهم كلهم هيك في ايام البنات اللي كانوا جوازهم كانوا يجيبوني في وحدة امها وخالتها جابوها وفتحها عماد كانت هي لسه تبنت
بيقول لها انتي شرموطتي انتي احبتي انا ردي وراي ردي وراي قولي قولي انك انتي شرموطة قولي انك انتي احبه بس لالي انا قولي اني انتي عم تنتاكي معي انا قولي انتي بدي كنياكي بكل جسمك قولي انتي شرموطة بكل جسمك اذا عندي كولاد قولي انه هن شرمت انه بنتك شرموطة ابني قواد بيقول مثلا انه تيزي كبيرة واقفة بدن يعكي بدي نيكيك من صدرك لازم الوحدة تضل هي مبتسمة وعم بتبادلوا نفس الكلام طبعا من جوا ما في وحدة من جوا أو من اللي أنا عرفتهم هي كانت مبسوطة أو ما أنا متأثرة من هالشي الأثر كتير كبير في حرقة في قهر إنك أنت ما خلقتي هيك ولا وحدة منا خلقت هيك في ظروف جبرت شي غصب عنك صار
شي مباح لإله هو بده يشتري بفكر انه هالبنت عبدة عنده انه هو شاريها بمصرياته ان شاء الله بيقتلها ان شاء الله بيغتصبها البنات بتكون بمزاد علني البنت كل ما بسطت بيعطيها اكتر اذا انت ما عملتي هيك ما بعطيك فهي بتضطر انه هي تعمل كل شي بده اياه لانه هو بيعتبر انه هو الطرف الاقوى شاركة ساعتين ثلاثة بمصريات في وحدة أكلت قتل كنت أنا بغرفة وهي بغرفة أكلت من واحد قتل إيه زبون بقلها أنت وحدة شرموطة وحقك 100,000 حقك بعمل فيك اللي بدي إياه إن شاء الله بنكيك من عيونك بدك تقبلي أنا دافع حقك ليش هيك لأنه هو بده يكتن كان بتمه وهي ما رضيت قالت له بدك تعطيني تبس اذا بدك تكتون بتمي كل شي مسموح بين قوسين للزبون كل شي مسموح الزبون ان شاء الله صار يعني يبول بتمه للبنت اكيد بدها تحس بقرف من جوا بس ما رح تبين انه هي قرفانه
بتحس الوحدة حالها انه هي خلص حياتها انتهت هون انا عبدة انا جارية صرت حس حالي انه انا شرموطة منتهك حقي اني انا جسمي عم يتاكل شوي شوي فكرت اكيد فكرت اني انا اموت انه هالشخص اللي عم يجي عم ياكل جسمك دعارة مو بس انه سوري يعني الوحدة عم تنتاك الوحدة من فوق لتحت عم تنتاك من فوق لتحت انه هي عم بتموت الشخص مو نايم مع وحدة نايم مع جسم الزبون ما بيفكر انه هالمرة انسانة لا بيصفها بالحيوانة يا ما في زباين الوا انه نحنا منجي بس لنفضي فيكي ونروح ممنوع تبكي بدك تبلعي البكوة وضلك ضحكاني حتى لو بدي نام معك اربع مرات في زبون بفوت ساعة وبنام مع الوحدة اربع مرات خلص انا دافع حقك بساعة يعني انا صرت بمكان عم انشرى وانباع انا بقولهم داعش مو اللي فات على سوريا عماد داعش الزباين داعش شي عم ياكلك انا شفت الاغتصاب بكل انواعه شفت القهر بكل انواعه شفت العذاب بكل انواعه عن جد لاني انا ما ماني بنت هيك ما خلقت لكون شرموطة
The survivors of Chemaurice said that each girl would sleep with 10 to 15 men on average per day, which means each woman was bought by 105 men per week. Nevertheless, when we talk about prostitution, we talk about women. The law incriminates the woman, society incriminates the woman. But the truth is that there are always way more men participating in prostitution than there are prostituted women. The woman is prostituted only if she has a prostitute. The Lebanese state did not provide anything to the victims of Chemaurice. Some were arbitrarily sent to shelters, while others were released without any kind of protection. In April 2017, the legal sanctions on Chemaurice were removed. The building was sold, and the new owner intends to demolish it, the only witness to the suffering of these women. The case of Chemaurice is the biggest human trafficking case faced by the Lebanese judicial system and the internal security forces. The court trials are still in progress. Imad Rihawi was released on June 21, 2017 on $13,000 bail. And Fawaz Ali Hassan, the head of the trafficking ring, was never caught. The second court hearing took place on Friday, July 7, 2017, at which nothing happened. Some of the accused didn't show up at the court, so the judge postponed the hearing until November 11, 2017. Meanwhile, Noor, one of the survivors, writes in her diary, "Ana imra'a taduru hawli alaf isharat al-istifham. Imra'a muzdahira min al-kharij wa mayyita min al-dakhil. I am a woman with thousands of question marks revolving around me. I am a woman blooming on the outside and dead on the inside."
Thank you.
Serious and most impressive reading. Thank you for bringing this to us. You know, we're going to talk a bit about the play, but also about the university and your work there. And a Peter remark.
Thank you.
So, Sahar, before we go to the university, maybe tell us you chose the play. Tell us a bit about it and.
Yeah.
How was it received and what?
So as I said, I mean, when the story came out, like many Lebanese, it traumatized me. I was devastated. And, it was still on my mind, like a year later when I got the opportunity with the Center of Arts and Humanities at UB to put on something related to the Syrian, war crisis and refugee crisis, I immediately thought about this story. So I started digging, and my initial attempt was basically to give voice to these stories and to the women, and you know, to just remind people that this happened. But as my research started, I noticed that, you know, in every single report or video I saw on the subject, mainstream media, there was no mention of the men who were, you know, frequenting these brothels. Not at all, not one mention. The media talked about the abortion doctor, as we said, as the narrator said, the security forces, the authorities who actually, you know, facilitated the network and its work. All the elements, you know, all the people that made, you know, this story were mentioned, except for the customers. And it just occurred to me that this is could not be possible. This should not be the case, because for me, these men were actually, you know, committing the crime with the trafficker and with, you know, the abortion doctor and others. So that became the focus of the performance, as it's, you know, as it's mentioned in the small note that we have in the program. The documentary piece builds on, it's really a hybrid kind of documentary theater. I used the verbatim interviews with survivors, but I also used the indictment report. I used interviews that other journalists, you know, did at, you know, with the survivors right when they were rescued. I used interviews I did with the colonel, with the, you know, head of trafficking and trafficking unit at Women, it's a women empowerment NGO, CAFAL, you know, the expert on the prostitution there. So she did a study which is the first of its kind in the Arab world about the demand for prostitution. So the study became also part of this piece. And I think one example I can give about the impact that the story had. So as I said, in the mainstream media, there was no mention. And then in July 7, which was the last performance in Lebanon of the piece, a reporter from a TV show on a national TV, one of the most watched TV programs, she was present, and you know, she listened to the play and she stayed for the talkback, which usually takes, you know, longer than the performance itself. Usually we stay for like an hour and 30 minutes to just allow the people time to process and debrief and all of this. So she was there, and it kind of struck her. She said that she never thought of this. So she went back and she dedicated 20-minute segment to talk only about the demand aspect of the, she talked about the case of Shay Maurice, but she really talked about the demand aspect. So that ensured my journey with this piece. Now the next, the future of this performance would be a national tour in Lebanon to keep telling the story, because it's still, the trials are still, you know, happening. Nothing is happening in the trials. The guy is trying to say that he's only a facilitator of prostitution, which in Lebanon, by law, is not, you know, he won't be incriminated or anything. So he's trying to, you know, get away from the trafficking. So I think it's very important to tell the story and to keep telling it. So this is one of the objectives of this piece.
So it happened at the University Theater on campus?
Yes.
And how long was the run?
The first performance was at AUB on the margins of the conference. It was actually the closing event of the conference that I mentioned with the Center of Arts and Humanities, and it's a theater initiative work. So that was the first performance, and then the Lebanese American University learned about it and they invited us to put a presentation there. And then the NGO that I was working with fully endorsed the performance, and we took it off campus to the city and we presented it at Al Madina Theater in Beirut. And then I traveled with the performance to Athens to between the Seas Festival. And now when I'm back in Lebanon, the plan is to do actually, you know, a tour to universities, schools, and remote areas in Lebanon to present it. So it was only three shows in Lebanon, but it's still in its very early phases. It's still work in progress, and we're still developing. I'm still interviewing survivors and, you know, other people that can help tell the story.
So courageous work to put on anywhere in the world. So congratulations. Marvin and Peter, what are your reactions?
Well, I am, I'm still curious to get a little more information about what the culture allows to be done. That is, can you say a little bit more about the judicial system, about what crimes are, you say the trials are going on. What crimes are being charged? What penalties are available to the legal system? That is, suppose a lawyer, let's say, committed to social justice, said, "All right, I want to do something about this." What is open legally? That is, the work you're doing is obviously important, which is to expose and make people aware of something. But I'm curious now as to what, let's say people say something must be done. What courses, what's available to them?
Yeah, legally in Lebanon, there's a lot of work that still needs to be done, especially in cases of trafficking. Right now, in the law, prostitution is, you know, when if a man and a woman were arrested in an act of prostitution, the woman is taken to jail, the man is set free. So this guy was actually arrested several times. You know, that's why I say in the play that the authorities, the security authorities, were actually perpetrators, and you know, as responsible, because they would go raid the brothels, take some women. And then the trafficker himself would go, and sometimes he was arrested, and he would claim that he's a client. And because he's a client, he can, you know, he's not charged with anything. But the women are put in prison. And then he would go and pay something, and then bribe the officers, and then they would be released. So when the last raid happened, the women really didn't believe that it's going to save them. So at first, they didn't say anything. And then after, like, four of them ran away, and anyway, so one thing I'm trying to do with this performance is to, you know, at least, you know, raise it in the conscience of the people. So, for instance, when I did the show at Al Madina, that was on the show was actually on July 4, and there was a trial happening on July 7. So I mentioned that, and I invited the people to go to the court. Because many people also in Lebanon don't know that this is an option, that these are open for the public. And to my surprise, when I went there on Friday the 7th, two of the audience members were there. Now, two is a very small number, obviously, but for me it was, you know, refreshing to see that people actually, they are interested now to know more about the story.
Women or men?
One woman, one man, actually, yeah. So, it's going to take a lot of time, but that's, I'm now working in close collaboration with CAFA NGO, which is a feminist, secular Lebanese NGO. For CAFA passed recently, in 2015, they passed a law against domestic violence, and it took them 7 years to pass the law. So now domestic violence is a crime in Lebanon. It wasn't before 2015. So I can imagine, like, such a law against prostituting women, how much time it's going to take to happen. But right now, if he's charged with a trafficking crime, he will be put in prison for at least 10 years. But what's happening now with his lawyer, and I met his lawyer and we talked over the phone, he's trying to actually say that the guy is simply a facilitator. They call it in Arabic, like musahel, facilitator, musahel al-da'araf, you know. So, and it might work. He's now released on bail, and it actually, you know, he might be able to get away with it.
Is prostitution itself a crime in Lebanon? That is, can a woman be prosecuted just on the charges of being a prostitute?
Yes.
Yes
and no, because there's really no clear law against prostitution. I mean, the authorities, they know that it happens. In Lebanon, there's the culture, for instance, of the super nightclub. They call it super nightclub, and this is a place where men go and they meet prostitutes, but they're not allowed to prostitute them on the premise. They go there, they pay money, they pay for alcohol, and the next day they take them out hotel. And so the authorities, they know, and they give visas to these women coming from Eastern Europe, from you know, Morocco, and they give them artist visa, which is still called, yeah.
Well, the,
that's very common.
It's well, and the
sex trafficking is
yes, and the situation is made more complicated by the sort of trafficking equivalent of consensual acts. That is to say, if let's say you have a let's say you have a culture like the Netherlands, where indeed prostitution is a business. That is, a woman can freely decide, this is something I want to do. She must get a permit from the government, she must undergo help. But you only get into trouble if it can be proven that she's coerced into doing this. And so that this adds another dimension, even though it's perfectly clear from the testimony that these people were coerced, that's another level that has to be proven. That this is that they're not. Especially it seems to me when their mothers or their aunts bring them, then it seems to me that that a prosecutor or a defender could say, well. They needed the money, they wanted to do this, they didn't have any other options, and so it is a consensual act that they're doing.
Yeah, this is what they're trying to say, I mean, in the courts, the sessions. You know, like, this is one thing that we wanted to highlight in the performance. So it started as, at least my journey in this piece started as just wanting to give voice to the stories, but then I found myself learning a lot more about prostitution. And the premise of the show, of the performance lecture, was to say actually that the ultimate goal is prostitution. So we can talk about trafficking and prostitution as the same thing. You know, at least with CAFA, this is our take on the issue. We're not separating between the two, because we believe that if you didn't need to sell them in prostitution, he wouldn't have trafficked them in the first place. What for? It's really for these men to come and buy, whether people call it service or the women. And if you listen to the testimonies that men share, sex buyers, they actually don't think of it as a service. They say, we're buying the woman. We are, you know, we pay 50,000 Lebanese lira, which is $33, and we can do whatever we want. Like, this is, and I put the voices of these men on stage. Not, they were not impersonated, but just their voices. And that juxtaposition between the sex buyers and what they believe and think and their views on women in general, not only women in prostitution, and the testimonies of these women. And I need to say that some of the interviews we shared, even tonight, you know, they happened right when the case was uncovered, but some of them a year later, when I started, you know, when I did the play, in April, exactly a year later. So you see, like, in reflection, these women talking about what prostitution in general does to the body of the women. So consent and, you know, the play really tackles all these questions in a way. Pardon, sorry.
Peter,
maybe
first, 1 second. First of all, thank you for sharing that piece. It's a very powerful piece of theatre, and it's a very rich insight, I think, into the complexity of theatre that's taking place in Lebanon. For me, it was a very powerful depiction of what Giorgio Agamben, the philosopher, calls bare life, where one exists in a state of bare existence. And also the form, the chosen form of verbatim theatre is an excellent form to, I think, present these stories of bare life, in fact. I mean, it's a form that is associated so often with theatres of the oppressed and theatres of people who have experienced hardship or sex trafficking or refugees and so on and so forth. I think it's a really strong piece, and I do like the way that you've dramaturgically made the piece also about this, you know, sexual economy of bodies. So
point that you make about the fact that you know, without the demand, there wouldn't be the service, in inverted commas, is a very powerful one. Could you, and also the use of the earphone and the recordings, could you imagine a situation where through a process of workshops, some of those women themselves could appear on the stage and tell their own stories
yeah.
in the way that perhaps Rimini Protocol do? And would that, I'm aware that that would be an enormous risk in some respects.
Totally.
And
yeah.
So, but could you imagine that that could be
but
something
sure,
that you could
but
work?
I think that would be, that would take a different kind of process. I would probably need to be doing more drama therapy kind of performance rather than documentary. Actually, Noor, the woman that I, you know, repeated her story tonight. So I interviewed her a year after, and she was still in the shelter. And she came and saw the performance at LEU. And during the interview, she was really composed. I was in tears, but she was like a strong woman, and she was just sharing the story. And then she came to LEU, and she listened to the entire piece, right, with her testimony, but others' testimonies. And she was devastated. She was in tears, like throughout. Luckily, we had two social workers come with her because we expected that such a thing would happen. So we kind of told her, Rada and myself, that this is going to be harsh, and we gave her the warning, but she insisted to come see it, and then she did. And then I kept visiting her once a week, doing some kind of closure with her because the interview was, you know, very traumatizing, I would say. So I kept seeing her once a week, and then at some point during this process, which took like 3 months afterwards, she kept saying that next time we do this play, she wants to be there and she wants to speak. At LEU, I came to her afterwards and said, do you want to say anything? And she's like, no. So, but later on, she kind of decided that she wanted to be there and she wanted to reveal her also identity, which is huge. Now Noor is in Canada.
Yeah.
She's resettled to Canada.
Yes. So I think this really is shows that a university theater can have a real impact, you know,
right.
in the life of a city, of a country. But this is just an example of
it's
your work, what you do. So tell us a little bit, how's your university structure? What can students study? What different fields? How many are doing that?
Right.
How many are on campus? How
right.
is it part of university life? So tell us a little bit about this theater initiative
so
also.
The theater initiative, really started as Robert and I meeting once and talking about co-teaching the production course together. He was translating Rituals of Science and Transformation by Saad Alawanous, and he's like, would you like to stage this play? And I'm familiar with the work of Wanous, and I went back and read the play again, and I came to Robert and I said, I don't think we should do this. It's, at least I can't do this with students. And I think that was my excuse of running away from Wanous, because his theater is really, I think it's, you know, quite difficult to tackle. But Robert had another idea. He said, what if we hire professionals to do the job, and then you can work with professionals and students. So, and that became our model. So we would always hire professionals, you know, actors, designers, but the students would also, Samer was in Rituals of Science and Transformation, he was still a student. So the kind of work we do is that we actually transform students from business into theater. Samer had a job with PwC after he graduated, and last year he came to me saying, Sahar, I'm resigning, I'm gonna go back and do theater. And it's from this course, right? Am I
yes,
exaggerating?
Yes,
it's
my experience
yeah.
with Sahar.
Okay, so Rayan, another student who worked with us.
Yeah, yeah.
So the theater initiative right now faces different challenges. One of them is the absence and the lack of infrastructure at AUB. But luckily the administration, the new administration, especially President Fadlu Khoury and Dean Nadia Sheikh, they're so keen on helping us find a permanent space. We really lack a space to rehearse sometimes, so that's why our work has been very eclectic. partly because this is what we like to do, and partly because we're trying to adapt the situation. So if we can't find enough money to rent a theater, we do site-specific, you know, on the street, on campus. The last few years have been really very busy for us. I mean, some of the examples I mentioned, some of the plays that we did. Students at AUB cannot major in theater yet. We have a minor. It's housed under the fine arts and the art history. Hopefully with this new collaboration partnership with you know, Martin Siegel and the PhD program here at CUNY, we're hoping that we will, you know, start soon, hopefully an MFA in, you know, theater studies or playwriting. We can talk more about this, I guess, tomorrow, but...
Let's talk about building a theater.
Oh, building a theater. That's, I mean, right now we're in the process of, the administration is looking, this is live streaming, and this is partly confidential, so I'm just gonna stop. But I'll tell you about that tomorrow.
Yeah.
It's we have there's serious. I can say there are serious moves towards acquiring a proper theater for AUB.
So, are you from a theater family? Because I noticed that.
Roger Hassaf, no, he's not my father. Everyone asks me if he's my father. He's a very, very, you know, great mentor and friend. We only worked together when we did Lear. We invited him to be the star. And no, we're not related by blood, but by theater.
So maybe it's a good moment to open up. I also want to point out that Joy Ara, who was a Next Generation Fellow at the Siegel Center for over a year and then worked at some film festivals, came from the American University of Beirut. We offered her, you know, work here, and then she went on to Columbia University, where she is about to finish her studies in theater management. So we have some strong existing connections, and I hope this initiative, you know, will even...
And Jenny from UCF.
Jenny.
Oh, Jenny, of course. Yes, our student.
She's also a graduate of AUB.
Yeah. Of Robert's program. Yeah.
Our student here.
And Robert was chair of my thesis.
Of your thesis, yes, of course. So there are really deep connections. So we have about, you know, 5-10 minutes for some questions. So we would like to open this up. And any comment or thought or question?
Is there a possibility that CUNY could host a full production of the play somewhere here in New York?
Yeah, I think the good thing is if you have money, you can do really almost everything. That's what it is about. I mean, there are CUNY theaters and others. And yeah, there are possibilities, perhaps, but something to think about, or maybe they come and direct a play here. Often it's expensive, you know, to bring over, but something to redirect.
Whenever I travel abroad and people say, tell me about the American theater, I always start by saying, it's all about money. First thing I say. So picking up on that, Frank, yes, I think that is true, but I think I would qualify this sounds kind of traitorous, I guess, but I would say if the money can be found to do a regular production, even in a small theater, then I would think and of course the Siegel Center is an admirable channel for this. There are countless very good small companies full of very talented people who would leap at the chance to be involved with this, not only because they leap at any chance where they might have a chance to act and perform, but this is such a special kind of case. I would say I think it's a great idea, but I think to think of it as would CUNY do this, I think it's not the way to go. I think would CUNY facilitate this with its connections in the New York theater world, especially through the Siegel Center, then I think this would be a perfect kind of thing for CUNY to be involved in.
Hi, thank you so much for your work. I mean, I think it's incredible. I did a piece
I directed a piece with young people who were survivors of sex trafficking in Brooklyn and Queens. So it's a topic that's like near and dear to my heart. And I was actually wondering what your experience was with audiences post-show, if it brought up issues of sexual assault or any other sexual violence, and if there were social workers for the audience members, and how basically how the audience was taken care of during that your talk back.
That's a very, very good question. After the show at Al Medina, the show in the city, I had a friend who's a drama therapist present in the audience. And the next day she called me to say, to share her experience. And she basically said that throughout the performance, she kind of dissociated and she was protecting herself because she knew how to do that. But she said, I had nightmares all night. And I need to tell you, Sahar, you need to give audiences a disclaimer. And I didn't even do that. And we did it here, but that was a mistake. You know, that's something I learned also. The reactions were quite intense, you know, not to the extent of people sharing this. The one example I can mention is also at Al Medina, one of the audience members, she shared that she was the first to speak, and she said that she knows the guy by name, that the trafficker, because he, at some point, he also did the same thing with her cousin in Syria. So he was doing that job in Syria and then came to Lebanon, probably because of the war. The talkbacks, or the open discussions, that we call them open discussions with the audience, took an hour at least. And we would stop because we get tired, and you know, audience needed more. And that, for me, was really at the essence of the matter. That was what's important, you know, for them to talk about the issue and to open this debate at a national level, you know, to make it of concern for them. I don't know if I answered your question, but this is, you know, I'm still thinking about what can be done there.
Maybe one last question over here.
The missing piece, the customers.
Uh-huh.
You didn't get hold of any interviews from the police or anything like that, because this can complete the story and the performance.
Yeah.
And maybe like also like as culture, these women are victims and the culture doesn't accept them. So the customers maybe reach like stories, maybe reach the culture, reach the people more, and maybe like, I don't know.
The only access I had to the sex buyers were actually from the study that CAFA did in 2014. So what they did is the study was called Exploring the Demand for Prostitution, and the researcher, Ghada Jabour, she went on and interviewed 55 sex buyers. And when I asked her about the small size of the sample, she said that basically it was very hard to get to them, because the places they go, like super nightclubs, these are not places accessible for researchers. But still, the 55 sample was, you know, gave great insight to the performance. So what I basically did is hired male actors to record the quotations I pulled from the study. And then these voiceovers were played when we played the testimony. So we would, like, they were, you know, kind of juxtaposed with, like, we would hear a testimony, narrator, testimony. You know, the narrator was basically my take and my analysis of the story. And then so that was for this, you know, at this stage, this is what I could get. But again, we're still developing this play. I'm still trying to seek funding to, you know, do the national tour, but also to document it in a documentary film. And then I will need to interview myself, sex buyers. It's not going to be an easy job. It's really, you know, they don't want to say it. They're proud. You know, they talk about it maybe to their friends, but they don't want to identify themselves. So it's, you know, as one would expect, right? But
so, Harsh, thank you for coming. You woke up yesterday morning still in Beirut, and you flew in, and we sit right here. Peter, maybe some closing remarks?
Just also on behalf of the program to thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
I think it's a really great start to what I hope is going to be a really wonderful exchange.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
You know, I think the serious nature of the work has really provoked me to to be excited by this exchange. I think it's really great. So thank you. And just also to thank a few people who've made this event happen. So you know, sometimes in universities you do things quickly because the opportunity is there. And we certainly put this program together rather quickly, and that's not a bad thing. That's the way universities happen sometimes. And but it has involved a lot of people, so who've really given time and energy. So first of all, to thank Marvin and Frank from our side, who you know, we met during the summer, and we had meetings with Robert, and also Joy Connolly, our provost, who's been very actively supporting this, as is President Chase Robinson. But perhaps more hands on the ground, there's been a number of people who've helped make this event happen. Jeannie Youssef, I think over there, you've done a really, really exceptional job today. Joy Arab, who has produced this event. I think you must be learning something up at Columbia. Yu Chen, who is always a stalwart for the Siegel Center, and Manon. Where's Manon? And Manon and Michael, who's been recording us and sharing your secrets. And who else?
Selma.
Sorry. So really, you know, and please stay for a bit of food and a bit of drink, and it's a time we can mix more socially. So thank you for your attention. Thanks for coming to us.
Thank you all.